Remittances are down 2.6% in the first 8 months of the year to just $21.4 billion, failing to sustain the bounce seen in June and July. Now, this morning, we're going to talk about the plight of migrant workers in Hong Kong with Mahee Leclerc. Hi, Mahee. Good morning.
Hello. Good morning.
Okay. So your latest survey, which covers September 2019 until September 2020 and the COVID pandemic in between, it shows us there are more job terminations for domestic workers in Hong Kong. So fewer jobs, but higher pay?
Yeah, so basically, we do this salary survey every year. Mm-hmm. And that this year, we found out that now the salary is higher than it was before. The average salary offered by employers is more than 5,000 Hong Kong dollars. But at the same time, the salary was frozen by the Hong Kong government. They usually increase the salary every year, the minimum salary. So we have really two things. We have on one side the Hong Kong government that froze the salary of domestic workers, and on the other side, domestic workers are getting higher paid by the employers just because there are less people here that it's basically the domestic helpers that are already in Hong Kong because less people can come from the Philippines directly.
Mm-hmm. So they are in demand.
Yes, they are. They are. A lot of families in Hong Kong rely on domestic workers. It's actually one out of seven families. So there is a high demand for domestic workers. At the same time, there are less people that are able to come.
Mm-hmm. So you mentioned earlier that the average salary for domestic workers in Hong Kong has reached the 5,000 Hong Kong dollars average. That's up by about 1.35% year on year. While it's still growing, it's not growing as fast as in previous years, but it is still growing. That the fact that it's still growing, that the wage is still rising, do you somehow see that disconnected from the harsh economic realities of Hong Kong? I mean, Hong Kong reached full-year recession as of the second quarter of this year. Unemployment there is at a 16-year high.
I don't think it's irrelevant to the current situation because foreign domestic workers actually do work a lot, and mm-hmm. the minimum salary is quite low compared to other workers in the city. Also, during COVID, the fact that the government froze the salary is kind of really not that accurate for them because they worked actually way more during COVID than before. We have 20% to 30% of respondents in our study that said that they had more longer working hours or their rest days were denied because of the situation, because they could not go out on their rest day. And also 20% of them were actually in fear of constant termination. So these are very stressful working conditions for them. So that's why this increase is actually, it's too bad that it's less than the previous years.
Mm-hmm. So we're now showing what you just mentioned, Mahee, the impact on work. And you did mention that over 30% of workers there said that they were given more workload, 24% said longer working hours, 21% said they had the constant fear of termination. There's just so many things going on in Hong Kong right now. Do you think it's become less appealing to migrant workers as a migrant worker destination? I mean, compared to other areas like Singapore or Malaysia or the West, perhaps?
No, I think it's still very appealing for foreign domestic workers. For example, it's quite close to the Philippines, so that's a really big point. Also, the salary is a bit higher than in other countries, mm-hmm. and the regulations are more in favor of domestic workers when it comes to holidays and rest days. So I think it's still a very attractive place for domestic workers to work in. It's just more difficult to come here in the first place because of COVID. I hope it will be better soon, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Uh-huh. It's not just COVID that hit Hong Kong. Even before COVID, there were the democracy protests that's really disrupted businesses there that have forced a lot of the moneyed individuals to relocate. And because of that, it also ended up dislocating Filipino domestic workers. How many OFWs were dislocated within that period, the 1 year period from September last year to this year? And how many of them are able to come home already to the Philippines and are still in limbo there?
So I don't have exact figure of how many in Hong Kong have seen their contract terminated because of this. But on HelperChoice, we've had an increase of 6% compared to usual years of the number of people looking for a job because of termination of their contract, mostly because of relocation of the employer or financial reason. And that is around 500 people during that connected to HelperChoice to find a job because of this between September last year and September this year. So a bit more than 500 people on HelperChoice. Right now we have put in place a process to help them find a new job in the city. The thing is, if they cannot find a job, they can now extend their visa, but at some point they have to go back to the Philippines. But again, I don't have the exact number of how many people have to go back and how many can actually stay in Hong Kong. The thing is, they can extend their visa. Most of them will try to extend the visa and stay in a boarding house for a little while to find a new job and before going back to the Philippines, because once they're back, it's really difficult to come again in Hong Kong to work.
Mm-hmm. Mahee, you mentioned earlier that OFWs are in demand in Hong Kong. So when you look at the supply and demand, are you seeing more job openings than there are available OFWs to fill them?
So before, there were a lot of OFWs, way more OFWs than job positions, right? Mm-hmm. Now, the number of domestic workers in Hong Kong decreased from 400,000 to like 375,000 in Hong Kong, not just Filipino, but also others. I think right now there is a kind of equal supply and demand, but sometimes employers are looking for very specific profiles, especially when it comes to childcare or elderly care.
Okay. Final question, Mahee. I mean, when you look ahead, what's the outlook for remittances? Remittances contribute around 10% to Philippine GDP. And I know that in 2018, for example, money brought back to the Philippines from OFWs working in Hong Kong, Singapore and Malaysia, for example, totaled over $1 billion. So far, we did see a bounce mid-year. June and July remittances in the Philippines picked up, and then they contracted again in August amid a large-scale repatriation. So do you have a projection for remittances to be sent home this year?
So in my opinion, there will be less remittances sent because of the economic situation. At the same time, I don't have the exact figure right now, but we are actually working on another survey that is targeting especially remittances, banking services, and all of these issues. So I'll keep you updated on this one.
Okay, and looking forward to speaking with you again. Thank you so much, Mahee, for joining us live this morning all the way from Hong Kong.